Mr. Hunt.
Oh, yes, indeed, Mrs. Duff. And God bless, I see you have brought some of your scones. In all the British Isles, Mrs. Duff has no match when it comes to making scones.
Oh, he does go on. Now, you two just help yourselves. And if there's anything you need, you only have to ring.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Mrs. Duff.
I really can't believe that I'm having tea with Mr. Leigh Hunt and talking about Byron, Keats and Shelley as if they were actually here.
They are very vivid in my memory, Miss Weston. Although I did not see quite as much of Lord Byron after those early days of fame in London. You see, he made a very unfortunate marriage. And then there was a terrible scandal involving his relationship with his half-sister, and he was forced to leave the country. That was in 1816, about the time I came to know Shelley and Keats.
I do think Keats is my favourite poet.
Oh, yes. Such talent, such command of imagery. He once said, Byron describes what he sees. I describe what I imagine. Mine is the hardest task.
And who else could have written, a thing of beauty is a joy forever. Its loveliness increases. It will never pass into nothingness, but still will keep a bower quiet for us and a sleep full of sweet dreams and health and quiet breathing.
The opening lines to Endymion. Very fine. Very Shakespearean. Keats was devoted to Shakespeare. But do you know, when that poem was first published, it was bitterly attacked by two of the leading literary magazines, Blackwood's and the Quarterly.
I've heard it said that's what contributed to his dying so young.
I know. In fact, it was Lord Byron who wrote, Who killed John Keats? I, says the Quarterly, so savage and tartly. 'Twas one of my feats. But you see, a critical review could never kill Junkets. Oh, that's what I used to call him, Junkets. He had too much spirit. Somehow people have come to think of him as a delicate, ethereal being, and he wasn't like that at all.
How did you meet him?
Through Charles Cowden Clarke, the one who used to send me baskets of fruit and vegetables while I was in prison. He sent me some of Keats' early poems, which I published in my paper, The Examiner. And pretty soon, he was a regular visitor to my cottage in Hampstead Heath. It's such a beautiful part of London. And how Keats loved to stroll during the day through the heath and around the pond near my home. That's where Shelley used to sail his paper boats. Then, of an evening, Keats and Clarke and I, and often the Shelleys, would gather together to enjoy music and poetry and, best of all, real friendship.
Bravo, Clarke. We actually finished together. What did you think of that, Junkets? Have we not proven that poets and musicians are of the same blood?
Sweet are the pleasures that to verse belong, and doubly sweet a brotherhood in song.
Hunt, your playing is better than ever.
Those 2 years in prison gave me ample opportunity for practicing. But you have always played well.
When I was a schoolboy in Enfield and Clarke was teaching there, I used to lie abed and listen to him playing in the parlour below. He introduced me to music just as he introduced me to poetry. I might never have considered giving up the study of medicine had you not taught me all the sweets of song. Spenserian vowels that elope with ease and float along like birds or summer seas.
Nonsense. You told me yourself that you were so inattentive during your anatomy lessons that one day, during a lecture, you saw a sunbeam come into the room and with it a whole troop of creatures floating in the ray, and thereupon you were off with them to Oberon and Fairyland. Come now, Keats, you were destined to be a poet.
Yes, but I had to learn and be inspired. Who read for me the sonnet, swelling loudly up to its climax and then dying proudly? Who found for me the grandeur of the ode, growing like Atlas, stronger from its load? Who let me taste that more than cordial dram, the sharp, the rapier-pointed epigram?
Good Lord, Clarke. Did you do all that?
When he lent me Spencer's The Fairy Queen, a whole world of beauty was opened that I had never dreamt upon. Wondrous descriptions like sea-shouldering whales. What an image that is.
And now, here is Junkets on the brink of publishing his own first collection of poems. That's worth another glass of sherry, don't you think?
Absolutely.
For God's sake, let us sit upon the ground and tell sad stories of the death of kings.
Ah, good, the Shelleys are here.
Hello, Keats. Mr. Clarke.
Shelley, Mary.
Now the party is complete. Come, have some sherry.
Keats, dear boy. And Clarke, I haven't seen you since before Christmas.
That's right. I must congratulate you on your recent marriage.
Why, thank you. It's been almost 2 months now, and we're still as happy as we were before.
And your baby?
Oh, he's happy for us, too. Tell me, Mr. Keats, what are your views on marriage?
Oh, heavens, I haven't thought about that. I have such idealized views of love. For the moment, the roaring of the wind is my wife, and the stars through the window pane are my children.
What an admirable approach to matrimony. Much less costly. And they all stay out of doors.
You can tell which one of us has four children.
Shelley, I was pleased to hear you quoting Shakespeare when you came in.
King Richard II. It's one of my favourite passages.
I can most assuredly attest to that.
Thank you.
Last month, we were riding to London together on the Hampstead stage. And one of our fellow passengers was a kindly old lady. Suddenly, Shelley springs up and shouts, Hunt, for God's sake, let us sit upon the ground. And I do declare, I've never seen such alarm on the face of anyone. She thought we were about to halt the stage and require everyone to sit along the road.
And next time, we will.
Have you held any more of your poetical competitions, Mr. Hunt?
Oh, let me see. Oh, I think the last one was the very day you were getting married, wasn't it, Clarke?
That's right, Shelley wasn't here.
I am glad you didn't give him a choice of which event to attend. What was the contest?
To write an impromptu sonnet on the subject of the grasshopper and the cricket. I had no stopwatch for the occasion, but Keats was clearly the winner as to time.
He also wrote the better poem. It's to be published in his collection. Do it for them, Junkets.
Oh, no, I'd really rather not.
What modesty. Well, I remember it. The poetry of earth is never dead.
Such a prosperous opening.
When all the birds are faint with the hot sun and hide in cooling trees, a voice will run from hedge to hedge about the new-mown mead. That is the grasshopper's. He takes the lead in summer luxury. He has never done with his delights. For when tired out with fun, he rests at ease beneath some pleasant weed. The poetry of earth is ceasing never. On a lone winter evening when the frost has wrought a silence.
Ah, it's perfect.
From the stove there shrills the cricket's song, in warmth increasing ever, and seems to one in drowsiness half lost, the grasshoppers among some grassy hills.
Mm. Ah, bravo, Keats.
Well done. Indeed. Poetry is the record of the best and happiest moments of the happiest and best minds.
Shelley must certainly attend the next competition.
If it is fairly soon. We are moving out to a new home in Marlow within the month.
How I envy you.
As you once put it, Hunt, the two divinest things this world has got, a lovely woman in a rural spot.
One day, Junkets, you'll find a Juliet to inspire your muse. Come, Clarke. Let us show the Shelleys how well we two can play.
Of course.
Those were splendid days there in Hampstead. Such happiness and such promise in those young poets. We did not know that Keats was already carrying the shadow of a dread disease, consumption. In 1818, when he was 23, Keats moved into a semi-detached house in Wentworth Place, living with a scholarly merchant named Charles Armitage Brown. The other side of the house was rented by Mrs. Samuel Brawne and her family, and it was her young daughter, Fanny Brawne, who became the idealized love that Keats had dreamed of.
Is that another new dress?
Yes. Do you like it?
Dear girl, it's lovely. You're the cleverest little seamstress I have ever met.
Isn't she? And yet just last week she declared that she would willingly change places with Miss Robinson because she was such a paragon of fashion.
Oh, what a stoop. To Miss Robinson, you are as superior as a rose to a dandelion.
Oh, indeed, sir, you are too forward. I shall dance out of your reach.
Oh, the ravishment, the bliss. Fancy has her, there she is, never fulsome, ever new. There she steps, and tell me, who has a mistress so divine?
Am I then a splendid angel, newly dressed, save wings for heaven?
Oh, that and more.
How you do brighten up, John, when Fanny enters the room.
And well he should, Mama. We are engaged.
Not officially, you're not. You are only 18. And Mr. Keats, who could have enjoyed a profitable profession in medicine, has not yet proven that he can support you through poetry. We shall have to see.
May I come in?
Of course, Mr. Brown, please do.
Good afternoon to our dear neighbour.
And my friendly keeper, without whom life would be even more of a series of fits and starts than it usually is.
Fits and starts indeed, Keats. When will I be able to persuade you not to scrawl your verses on bits of paper, which you then leave scattered about the house where they can be thrown out by a maidservant or blown out by any passing breeze?
Calm yourself, dear Charles.
Did I tell you that one day last month I discovered Keats thrusting scraps of paper behind the books in our bookcase? It could have lain there forgotten for months, or been lost altogether. I retrieved one of the papers, and what did I find written? Thou wast not born for death, immortal bird. No hungry generations tread thee down. The voice I hear this passing night was heard in ancient days by emperor and clown. Perhaps the selfsame song that found a path through the sad heart of Ruth, when, sick for home, she stood in tears amid the alien corn. The same that oft-times hath charmed magic casements, opening on the foam of perilous seas, in fairy lands forlorn.
That's the poem you wrote, sitting out under the plum tree.
About our nightingale, Fanny. The one we hear singing in the early evening.
And but for me, that stanza might well have been lost. Now I make fair copies of everything, whatever John writes. I must say, this spring he's been astonishingly prolific.
Inspiration is close at hand.
What did you think of the most recent ode, Mrs. Brawne? The one inspired by the Grecian urn?
It's lovely. I must confess that several of the stanzas have been running through my head constantly. Thou still unravished bride of quietness, thou foster child of silence and slow time, sylvan historian, who canst thus express a flowery tale more sweetly than our rhyme? What leaf-fringed legend haunts about thy shape, of deities or mortals, or of both, in Tempe or the dales of Arcady? What men or gods are these? What maidens loathe? What mad pursuit? What struggle to escape? What pipes and timbrels? What wild ecstasy? Heard melodies are sweet, but those unheard are sweeter. Therefore, ye soft pipes, play on. Not to the sensual ear, but more endeared pipe to the spirit ditties of no tone. Fair youth, beneath the trees thou canst not leave thy song, nor ever can those trees be bare. Bold lover, never, never canst thou kiss, though winning near the goal. Yet do not grieve. She cannot fade. Though thou hast not thy bliss, for ever wilt thou love, and she be fair. O Attic shape, fair attitude, with breed of marble men and maidens overwrought, with forest branches and the trodden weed, thou, silent form, dost tease us out of thought as doth eternity. Cold pastoral. When old age shall this generation waste, thou shalt remain, in midst of other woe than ours, a friend to man, to whom thou sayst, beauty is truth, truth, beauty. That is all ye know on earth, and all ye need to know.
You're writing so well, John.
And with such ease, such facility.
If poetry comes not as naturally as leaves to a tree, it had better not come at all.
You'll soon have enough for a new volume.
And what a volume it will be. Isabella, Hyperion, The Eve of St. Agnes, these new odes.
And the critics will not dare treat it as they did Endymion.
To be sure. And we must finish it soon, so come along, Keats. Write 15 good lines, and I'll treat you to an evening at the theatre. Brown here is the luckiest soul in the world. Now, how can you say that? You have youth, genius, a beautiful helpmate.
Yes, but you have a lifetime passed to Drury Lane.
Work well, John. I shall be thinking of you. And there shall be for thee all soft delight that shadowy thought can win, a bright torch and a casement ope at night to let the warm love in.
Keats was indeed writing well, but in the months that followed, his burst of creative energy gradually went into a decline. And on a cold winter night in 1820, a foreboding became a fact.
My spirit is weak. Mortality weighs heavily on me like unwilling sleep.
What is the matter? You're fevered.
I rode back from town on the outside of the stage till I was severely chilled. And now I don't feel it. Fevered, of course, a little.
You should get into bed now. I've brought you some spirits. Poor chap, you must learn to take care of yourself in this bitter weather.
That is blood from my mouth.
Bring me the candle, Brown, and let me see this blood.
I know the color of that blood. It is arterial blood. I cannot be deceived in that color. That drop of blood is my death warrant. I must die.
By the summer of 1820, Keats knew for certain that his consumptive disease was mortal, and his doctors advised him to seek a warmer climate in Italy. He lived with me for a month or so, and then moved in with Fanny and her mother for his last days in England.
So, this is to be the day then, John?
Yes, it is time. The cold winds are beginning to blow towards evening. Fanny has ordered me a carriage. I shall go into town and make final arrangements with the publishers before sailing.
I understand that Shelley has invited you to stay with him in Pisa.
Yes, but I have declined. In such a circle as Shelley's, I should not be a free agent. But I am going to send him my latest volume.
I'm sure he'll be very pleased. Now you've won over the reviewers.
And have I won over your blessing to my marrying Fanny?
When you return from Italy, I shall be very happy to see you married and living here with us. Yes, Fanny.
Dear girl, you look fatigued. Your eyes are red.
I walked over to the stables at Church Lane to confirm the carriage. The air's a bit brisk this morning, that's all.
Ah.
I have some things for you.
And I for you.
But you've already given me your folio Shakespeare and Spencer's Fairy Queen.
I hope you've looked through it. I mark the passages I think the most beautiful. Sea shouldering whales. If I could have written that.
Think what you have written, John. The world will soon forget the carping of your critics and the indifference of your friends. But not your poetry.
No, I've left no immortal work behind me. Nothing to make my friends proud of my memory. But I have loved the principle of beauty in all things. I've been thinking, Fanny, of other poems I would write. And at least a few fine plays. Let me have another opportunity of years before me, and I will not die without being remembered. When I have fears that I may cease to be before my pen has gleaned my teeming brain,
before high pilot books and charactery, whole like rich garners, the full ripened grain. When I behold upon the night's starred face huge cloudy symbols of a hieromance, and think that I may never live to trace their shadows with the magic hand of chance. And when I feel, fair creature of an hour, that I shall never look upon thee more, never have relish in the fairy power of unreflecting love, then on the shore of the wide world I stand alone and think, till love and fame to nothingness do sink.
You mustn't have thoughts of death, John.
How can I not? Well, I should wish mine were worthy of my Juliet. There's a great difference between going off in warm blood like Romeo and making one's exit like a frog in a frost. Here now. I want to see what's in your basket. I love presents. Are there presents?
Just some little things for your journey. Here's a pocketbook. You've needed one.
Yes, yes, I have. Thank you.
And this paper knife for opening my letters.
I shall hold it in readiness every morning.
Will you write to me from Rome, as you did when you were on the Isle of Wight? Remember? You asked me to send you a letter immediately and said, make it rich as a draught of poppies to intoxicate me. Write the softest words and kiss them so that I may at least touch my lips where yours have been.
But for myself, I know not how to express my devotion to so fair a form. I want a brighter word than bright, a fairer word than fair. Oh, my love, I almost wish we were butterflies and lived but 3 summer days. 3 such days with you I could fill with more delight than 50 common years could ever contain. I want you to have the miniature portrait of me that Seven painted. It's a good likeness.
I shall never need refer to it. Now, when I think of you in Italy, I shall take up the copy of Dante you gave me. On the flyleaf, I've inscribed the sonnet declaring your love. Bright star, would I were steadfast as thou art. Not in lone splendor hung aloft the night, and watching with eternal lids apart, like nature's patient, sleepless eremite, the moving waters at their priest-like task of pure ablution round earth's human shores, or gazing on the new soft fallen mask of snow upon the mountains and the moors. No, yet still steadfast, still unchangeable, pillowed upon my fair love's ripening breast, to feel forever its soft fall and swell, awake forever in a sweet unrest, still, still to hear her tender taken breath, and so live ever, or else swoon to death.
John, the carriage is here.
Tell them I'm coming.
Well, this last thing, John. Your travelling hat. I've lined it with silk and kept a piece for myself.
You are the cleverest little seamstress I have ever met. Please, stay. I wish to leave alone, unaided.
Thank you.
Goodbye, dear friends.
Goodbye, John.
I shall write to you from Rome.
And we shall see you again come spring. And we'll listen for the nightingale.
Come spring. Yes, of course. Come spring.
Keats died in Rome just 5 months later, at the age of 25. He was buried in the Protestant cemetery, and as he had requested, his epitaph read, "Here lies one whose name was writ in water." And in the north of Italy, hearing of Keats' death, Shelley began to write one of the finest of all elegies.
"I weep for Adonais. He is dead. Oh, weep for Adonais. Though our tears thaw not the frost which binds so dear a head. And thou, sad hour, selected from all years to mourn our loss, rouse thy obscure compeers and teach them thine own sorrow. Say, with me died Adonais. Till the future dares forget the past, his fate and fame shall be an echo and a light unto eternity.